Hello everybody, I am Somesh Bhomik speaking to you from Kolkata. You know, it feels very strange having to deliver a lecture in this fashion. I don't mind the virtual platform, but what I am really missing is the warmth and direct engagement of a live audience. But what to do? You have to accept the reality of these very strange times. So we have to abide by the restrictions imposed on us by this pandemic of COVID-19. My only solace is that film actors day in and day out enact their roles far away from their prospective audience, even in normal times. So let me try to do the same here. I am grateful to Guwahati Cine Club for inviting me to share some of my latest thoughts on Indian cinema. Particularly, I am honored to be able to pay homage to the person in whose memory this annual lecture series is dedicated, Jyothi Prasad Agarwal. He was an iconic cultural activist of Assam. But believe me, his reputation reached far beyond his state, Assam. He was one who had tried to make strong social statements through his efforts. He had a very brief film career though. It spanned only two films and was cut short by his ill health and an untimely death. But even there, he made his mark as a practitioner far ahead of his times. Both his films were praised by connoisseurs and peers, but Agarwala was not so lucky with his audience. His films did not have box office success. You know, film practice, not simply in India, but around the world, is not confined to filmmaking only. It also involves reception by the audience or spectators. These two sets of people complement each other and constitute the totality of film practice. Yet, in India, this cultural negotiation is mediated by a non-cultural entity or phenomenon called film censorship. Significantly, the year 2020 marks the centenary of the inauguration of film censorship machinery in India. So I thought it would be an appropriate time to take stock of how both filmmakers and their audience have been affected by the trajectory of film censorship in India. The title of my presentation, as you know, is From a Cinema of Underdevelopment to a Cinema of Post-Colonial Rhetoric. Here, I will try to show how the film censorship regime has shaped Indian film practices, both of the filmmakers and also of the audience. By now, it is well established that India's film censorship regime is characterized by a complex and problematic engagement between its colonial past and post-colonial present. Through an interplay of continuity and change, it has given rise to two distinct epochs of content creation and reception. Censorship regime was introduced in India through the Indian Cinematograph Act of 1918. The then British rulers desired that cinema should unflinchingly serve their colonial interests. There was no indigenous film industry at that point of time, and the canons of censorship targeted films imported from the West, especially the USA. The British wanted these films to create a rosy picture about the West and the Western people's intentions in the colonies. The provincial censor boards constituted in 1920. That's why we are marking the centenary of film censorship in India. The provincial censor boards constituted in 1920, and each one technically autonomous, had before them detailed guidelines regarding sensitive issues, objectionable subjects, and forbidden scenes in foreign films, actually meaning films from Hollywood and the European countries. The administration, however, reckoned that an Indian film industry might emerge at some point of time and cause them some worries. To negotiate such an eventuality, each of the provincial censor boards in Bombay, Calcutta, Madras, Rangoon, and Lahore was placed under the jurisdiction of the respective city police commissioner. Eventually, as an indigenous film industry began to emerge in the mid-1920s, the bureaucracy began to exercise executive powers provided for in the Indian Cinematograph Act 1918. The idea was twofold. One, to bully the boards into submission, and B, to subjugate the unhindered development of theme and content within the fledgling film industry. To keep matters totally under bureaucratic control, the censorship decisions were put beyond jurisdiction scrutiny. The philosophy of film censorship in pre-independence India was based on three basic principles. One, to deny the Indian audience any access to rising communist or socialist ideals. In the official language or administrative language, it was called propaganda and coming from Soviet Union. Two, to ensure that the spirit of freedom and independence, as reflected in American films, did not reach the audience of a colonized country like India regularly. And three, to prevent the crystallization of nationalist paradigm in the Indian cinema. It is, however, significant that the British rulers chose to foreground the safety of the audience and the prevention of degrading or moral performances in order to camouflage their real, that is, political intentions. This resulted in a stifled growth pattern of colonized India's cinematic content from the 1920s. There were two reasons for that. One, the vigilance of an omnipresent and over-enthusiastic censorship machinery, which was itself under strict surveillance of a suspicious administration. And two, the inability of Indian filmmakers to confront the censors with courage and conviction. Of course, the filmmakers were handicapped by the sweeping and generalized restrictions imposed on film themes and subjects, all in the name of the safety of the audience and the prevention of degrading or moral performances. Such a scenario compelled the Indian filmmakers to stick to certain broad patterns of formal composition and thematic representation that emerged in the silent era, like mythological films, historical films, stunt films, and social films. These four types were broadly the type of films that were available in the Indian film market. Each of these types had consistent set of convictions in their narrative content and formal patterns. And this made them extremely popular with the audience. In this way, they gave birth to what we can call a cinema of underdevelopment. This cinema of underdevelopment distorted the development of capitalist socio-economic system and bourgeois ideals in an underdeveloped country fettered by colonialism. This cinema of underdevelopment incorporated two distinct trends. On the one hand, it adopted inefficiently the styles and conventions of bourgeois cinema, spectacularly churned out from the Hollywood. But unlike bourgeois cinema, it celebrated divine, supernatural, and celestial powers, as well as superhuman and spiritual characteristics in human beings. This cinema projected either a vulnerable image of humanity or a secular human existence weighed down by powers of fatalism. On the other hand, Indian people's exposure to the better works of world cinema was severely impaired. This was on account of the hawkish presence of the censor boards and frequent interference from the colonial administration. Consequently, it had a palpably adverse effect on audience taste and preference. Emergence of a serious film culture was out of question in this atmosphere, and cinema was left to develop, or rather underdevelop, either as a magic or a monster, hemmed in from all sides with either amused or jaundiced looks. Post-independence, the rulers surprised everybody by choosing to retain the system of film censorship introduced by the British. This was done despite giving the Indian citizens right to freedom of speech and expression in the newly framed Constitution of 1950. The official perception about the film medium did not change from the colonial era. The widely publicized post-colonial rhetoric like rationality, freedom, justice, right, modernism, progress, and development were often bypassed by the film censorship machinery. Cinema remained equally vulnerable to administrative pressures and susceptible to the politicians' malice in the new era. The majority of political leadership of independent India was against the idea of treating entertainment with leniency. They associated it with harmful Western influence that needed to be checked or purged. They repeatedly invoked the principles of morality and behavior as laid down by our forefathers in matters relating to exhibition of films. The bureaucracy was also bent on the adoption of a stricter code of censorship. The foundation for all this was laid with the passage of a new Cinematograph Act in 1952, which replaced the old Cinematograph Act of 1918. But surprisingly, the provision of pre-censorship remained very much part of it. The new Cinematograph Act set in motion an interplay between continuity and change. The modes of content control characteristic to the colonial film censorship regime remained available even in independent India. Only its operational elements were left open to future modifications by the bureaucracy, thus creating a facade of change. Question is, why did cinema continue to remain vulnerable to political and bureaucratic manipulation in the post-colonial period? After independence, the political leadership embraced the institutional legacies of colonialism. They especially courted the civil bureaucracy and the police. It was a process that began during the interim government of 1946-47 and persisted through the dominion period, which began in 1947 and ended in 1950. This facilitated internalization of authoritarian methods by the Indian politicians in power on the pretext of better governance. At that time, it did not attract much public criticism, owing to the prevalent political climate. India had earned her independence after a sequence of catastrophic events lasting almost a decade, starting with the Second World War, 1939-1945, then communal riots of 1946-47-48, partition which happened in August 1947, and the dispute over the accession of Kashmir to India in 1948. The adverse socio-economic impact of the Second World War, the human cost of the riots, the political implications of territorial consolidation after a bloody partition, and the complex military engagement against Pakistan in Kashmir, together with its diplomatic fallout, had a traumatic effect on the infant nation state. The situation leveraged the Indian rulers against certain crucial components of classical democracy on the pretext of discipline, stability, and social progress. At the same time, the leaders of independent India tried to develop a post-colonial social formation based on ideological concepts like nation-state, nationalism, modernity, and progress. They also reckoned democracy as its political ideology and planned development as its economic agenda. But this drive floundered around the formation of a cultural policy. The leaders enthusiastically advocated rationality and scientific temperament in their public statements, but privately they deferred to regional orthodoxy and traditionalism. This completely disoriented the cultural formation in the post-colonial India. Cinema epitomized this confusing, problem-ridden scenario. Perhaps more so because of its technological nature in contrast to the more conventional art forms. The burden of its stigmatized existence, a legacy of the colonial period, further problematized its cause. The post-colonial Indian society condemned cinema to an ambiguous position, jeopardizing its autonomous journey and search for freedom of expression, especially in the realm of political filmic representation. There were indeed diverse pulls and pressures on film medium from different quarters. Since the 1950s, an elaborate scenario emerged around the so-called pan-Indian Hindi cinema, advocating out-and-out entertainment. It earned an artificial preeminence as the vehicle of official language. Often, it began to attract attention in a manner disproportionate to its share and quality of input. Quality of output. Even the strident regionalism of the South Indian states reconciled itself to the regular production of Hindi remakes of successful local language films for an all India market. This cinema was characterized by a pseudo-modernist melodramatic structure, which eventually became the model for regional commercial cinema also. But the influence of cinema literacy in the more enlightened sector of the society, which was evolving at that time, gave rise to a different brand of film culture. Cinema was acknowledged as a serious form of expression with a resonant voice, discursive text, and responsive audience. There evolved a modernist paradigm for cinema, with emphasis on analysis and realism. Some people assigned a proactive developmental role to cinema, preferring factual construction, analytical paradigm, and direct address. Their demand was for documentary cinema. Against these proponents were the antagonists of cinema, who weighed this medium with jaundiced looks, treating it as very harmful for the society. And above them all was a state which wanted cinema to foster a culture of responsible citizenship. While some of these articulations were indeed very well structured, emphatic, and organized, the majority was rather loosely formed, intermittent, haphazard, and scattered over speeches, leaflets, public communications, private discussions, and even stray remarks and comments. Yet their summation produced a synergy, ultimately turning into a substantial discourse around the around the post-colonial Indian cinema. Within this discourse, the non-official public voice overshadowed the official voice of the state. As a result, the malice and apathy exhibited by the political elite were more often than offset by a remarkable upswing in the popularity of cinema. There was, however, an exception to this general pattern of discourse around cinema in the post-colonial India, and that involved film censorship. In this area, the official voice of the state was more assertive than the public voice. The appropriation of film censorship machinery of the pre-independence days is a sure manifestation of this assertiveness. Significantly, the basic framework for this machinery was finalized even before parliamentary democracy started functioning properly in independent India. The first general elections conducted on the basis of universal adult suffrage were held between 25th of October in 1951 and 24th of February in 1952. The first session of the newly constituted Indian Parliament was convened on the 13th of May 1952, but the Indian Cinematograph Act of 1952 had already received presidential assent on 21st of March 1952, that is almost 2 months before the first session of the duly constituted Indian Parliament was convened. And this act, on the strength of the presidential assent, came into force with effect from 12th of July, that is 2 months after the session was convened. Remarkably, the Indian citizenry did not resent the continuation of film censorship in a post-colonial democratic India. They rather felt secure in this arrangement. The society, by and large, accepted the presence of a state agency as the best method for neutralizing the pulls and pressures on post-colonial Indian cinema. Perhaps we can even suggest that the post-colonial censorship regime was installed by manufacturing a broad-based social consent. Different interest groups discovered elements of merit within the censorship machinery for their respective constituencies. The state was also happy acting as an arbiter and also a manipulator of popular perception about cinema. Meanwhile, both the cinematic diegesis as well as spectatorial response in the realm of cinema in India went through palpable changes. These were triggered by several upheavals within the Indian society and polity. A myriad of scopic options were created and thrust upon the audience on the pretext of entertainment, realism, and contemporaneousness. It was not a natural reflection of the desire and demand of the general film audience. Their tastes and preferences were constantly being manufactured and manipulated. In a symptomatic extension of their helplessness before the diversity of social phenomena, the Indian audience succumbed meekly to the machinations of film industry. By the 1960s, the Indian filmmakers were no more simply creating spectacles or pageants and manufacturing dreams. They were rather embedding contemporary rhetoric within the diegetic space, shaping popular visions and aspirations. An illustrative but not necessarily exhaustive list of such rhetoric will look like nation building and national reconstruction, as reflected in Mother India, conflict between law-abiding citizenship and lawlessness, as shown in Diwar, unrest and protest of the youth, as shown in the film Naxalite, neo-morality of the post-colonial period, as reflected in Kama Sutra, violence growing out of social disparity, as shown in Bandit Queen, social permissiveness, as shown in Fire, strident nationalism, as reflected in Border, or aspiration for global exposure, as shown in Zindagi Na Milegi Dobara. The idea was to limit the spectatorial response to either comfort or catharsis. Recurrence of this process produced a desensitized mass audience totally incapable of personalized human emotion vis-a-vis screen images. They fell victim to an artificial herd mentality after being spoon-fed and manipulated by filmmakers with specific agenda. On another plane, parameters of spectatorship were determined by, to a large extent, by state vigilantism, as reflected through censorship actions. The post-colonial administration did not miss a single opportunity to fine-tune the film censorship machinery. It was always on the lookout for emerging trends or issues in society or polity that could have an impact on cinematic representation and that could be uncomfortable for them. The Indian state showed remarkable alacrity in identifying these trends and making interventions. In a nutshell, film censorship in post-colonial India turned out to be not quite an arrangement through which the state imposed repression overriding popular dissent. It rather gave rise to a terrain for the power play that would start creating and recreating rules. In the process, parameters and boundaries of debate, categories and subjects were earmarked. From this labyrinth emerged a discourse of post-colonial filmic representation. It centered around several rhetorics defining various moments of India's society and polity. This oeuvre of rhetorical cinema is by and large consistent with the operational principles of prevalent censorship machinery. It has also given rise to an uncritical spectatorial culture, not conducive to a robust film practice. As a retrospect, I need to add that there are very significant exceptions to these trends to which I have referred in the realm of both filmmaking and spectatorial practices. But I also emphasize that these are not strong enough to subvert this broad scenario which I have described above. Mainstream Indian cinema post-independence is more dependent on rhetoric than on critical outlook. Thank you.